Random House Audio presents The Necessary Revolution by Peter Senge, Bryan Smith, Nina Kruschwitz, Joe Laur, and Sarah Schley. Read for you by Patrick Frederick. Featuring Peter Senge.
Hello, this is Peter Senge, and I'd like to welcome you to this audio book, The Necessary Revolution. The ideas, tools, methods, approaches that we'll be talking about in this program come from about a decade of work with people in all sorts of different organizations who are really stepping ahead to create a world that can really be one we can pass along to our children and grandchildren with real confidence. There are a whole host of fundamental issues in the world today which we are all aware of, whether it's climate change or terrorism or gap between rich and poor, waste, toxicity, water. It's easy to look at these as separate, as fragmented, but in fact they're not. They've arisen as outcomes of an underlying set of processes or imbalances that really need to be understood by all of us. We are living in a way that simply won't continue. The underlying thinking, the way of operating that has grown through the Industrial Revolution, has within it inner contradictions. These contradictions, once they're understood, start to point to very different ways we can operate in the future. There are two aspects to the program. They roughly correspond to understanding where we're at and then starting to see what we can do differently. There are a set of imbalances that we need to appreciate, and particularly where they come from. But of course, all of that is only as useful as knowing what to do. There are a set of strategies, tools, and methods that we find are used again and again and again by many of the most successful sustainability innovators in the world. These people are in businesses, they're in non-governmental organizations, they're in community organizations. They're working across the interface of all of the above. And they've learned how to get people working together to truly create a more sustainable world. As we get started, I'd like to ask you to consider one question. It'll kind of be the context for everything we're doing, and we'll loop back to it periodically. And it really has to do with, what does all this mean for you? What does it mean for me? It's easy to be standing on the sidelines vis-a-vis all these big issues. After all, they are really big. It's easy for any of us to go, well, you know, what can I do? I didn't create climate change. I didn't create whatever. But in fact, that's not entirely accurate. You know, the problems that exist in the world come as a byproduct of how all of us are living. Even more importantly, there are many things all of us can do, particularly as we work through the institutions in which we operate. The focus of the necessary revolution is not just individual change, it's organizational change. It's change amongst the networks of organizations that shape the modern way of living. So, as we get into the ideas, and as you go through the various stages in this journey, periodically, do stop and ask, what does this mean to me? What does this mean to my organization? And most importantly, what does it mean to me as a person? What's my part of this, and what's my part of the solution?
Endings, new beginnings, a future awaiting our choices. Anyone visiting Australia today cannot help but notice massive billboards in all the major cities encouraging people to conserve water. A natural response would be to think these are the result of recent drought conditions. And indeed they are, in a way. But though the signs are new, the drought they were erected in response to has gone on for years and shows no sign of improvement. Across the nation, water reservoirs are at roughly one quarter of capacity and have been declining for a decade, thanks to a combination of subnormal rainfall and rising temperatures widely attributed by leading scientific panels to climate change. Starting in 2007, water became the focus of national debates. One popular suggestion even called for the complete elimination of the nation's large citrus crop. This sounds drastic, but when there is simply not enough water to go around, hard choices need to be made, even if that means sacrificing an important crop in an industry that accounts for roughly 3% of GDP. But in addition to conserving resources such as water, innovative Australians everywhere are also seizing the opportunity to rethink and recreate their lives and the infrastructures that govern them. They are working together in communities across the country to come up with renewable energy solutions and beginning to consider sweeping changes in energy and water industries. Business, long dominated by mining and mineral industries, has become a vocal advocate for investment in innovative alternative energy technologies, such as wind and solar. Half a world away, Sweden has parted ways with other industrial economies to completely sever their dependence on imported oil and the vulnerability that goes along with it. Under former Prime Minister Göran Persson, a commission was established in 2006 that laid out a 15-year plan to cut fossil fuel use to zero by 2020. This momentous shift was, in fact, the outcome of decades of work by remarkable networks of public and private sector leaders committed to making northern Sweden the world's first bioregion, in which all energy needs are met from sustainably produced biofuels. Similar changes are occurring in businesses the world over. In response to the turmoil of world oil markets and oil-producing regions, DuPont, one of the largest and oldest companies in America, has set itself on a course to shift its product line from petroleum-based to bio-based feedstocks. Like many companies around the world, DuPont has worked for years to reduce waste, including carbon dioxide, CO2, emissions. But it now sees that the real innovation opportunities lie in the creation of new products that break the company's dependency on conventional oil and gas entirely. Similarly, Nike has reduced its carbon footprint by more than 75%. But again, by looking for the truly innovative opportunities for the future, the company has declared its intent to achieve zero waste, zero toxicity, and 100% recyclability across its entire product line by 2020. Our company and our customers care about health. Our products and ways of producing them should embody this, says Darcy Winslow, former head of the women's footwear division. But to do this, we're having to completely rethink how we design, produce, and distribute those products and how we recover them at the end of their lifetime. There are many types of revolutions. History talks mostly of political revolutions, dramatic events that all too often represent little real change over the long term. The cast of players and power shifts and new political philosophies come into vogue, but when it comes to the daily realities of most people, little changes. But occasionally, something different happens, a collective awakening to new possibilities that changes everything over time, how people see the world, what they value, how society defines progress and organizes itself, and how institutions operate. The Renaissance was such a shift, as was the Industrial Revolution. So, too, is what is starting to happen around the world today. Perhaps surprisingly, the most visible signs of this new revolution are a mounting series of environmental and social crises. While Australia's water situation may seem extreme, it is hardly unique. Both the southeast and southwest regions of the United States are facing a similar need for rationing and possible permanent cutbacks. In developed countries around the world, previously taken for granted aspects of daily life, food, water, energy, predictable weather, seem less and less reliable. Each of the last several summers has brought record heat waves to much of Europe, as well as other strange occurrences, such as extreme flooding, crops that come to season a month early, and the appearance of mosquito-borne diseases previously known only to the Southern Hemisphere, events that scientists have linked to global warming and increased atmospheric CO2. In the United States, there have been repeated scares about contaminated food imported from Asia and E. coli outbreaks from crops grown in our own backyard, recent warnings to parents about the rapid spread of poison ivy caused by higher CO2 levels in the atmosphere, which both speed the plant's growth and increase its toxicity, and a historic shift in the politics of energy. Even former protectors of the oil-fueled economic status quo now recognize that America's energy consumption, we consume 25% of the world's fossil fuels with only 5% of the population, cannot continue. Our rampant consumption and protect-the-source foreign policies no longer offer a reliable path for the future. As President Bush admitted, America is addicted to oil. While environmental crises get most of the headlines today, the simple fact that the wealth of the 200 richest people in the world exceeds the combined annual income of the world's 2.5 billion poorest people should give anyone pause, as should the knowledge that almost half of the world's population lives on less than...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.